In our first chapter, we're going to jump straight into minerals. And minerals are the building blocks that make up rocks. And rocks, in turn, make up our planet. But before we get too in-depth with minerals, we're going to start off with what exactly is a mineral and what kind of characteristics does it have to be considered a mineral. Minerals are a super important part of our lives. Because minerals make up just about everything around us and things that we use on day-to-day bases. But when we're studying minerals, this is a field of geology called mineralogy. And the reason that we want to study minerals is because minerals are the building blocks of rocks. If we start combining small pieces of different minerals together, we can combine them to form new and different forms of rocks on our planet. And all of these could have multiple different uses. And we're going to see that even since early humans, when we were hunting and gathering, we were actually using things like flint and chert for our weapons and for tools. We started using metals like gold, silver, and copper just a couple thousand years ago. And even today, we see that our life is ruled by minerals because we're all using electronics. And we see that quartz is a major component of the silicon in our computer chips. But before we get into all the minerals and their different uses, we have to define what a mineral is first. And there are five characteristics that make something a mineral. I'm going to be very honest here. I'm probably going to ask you this on the first exam. So it's going to be important to know these five different characteristics for what makes something a mineral. And we're going to go into each of these in a little bit more detail. But the first is that a mineral has to be naturally occurring. It also has to have an orderly crystalline structure. It has to be a solid substance. It can't be a liquid or a gas. It has to be a solid. It also has to be inorganic. And we'll get into how the terminology for organic is different between geology and with chemistry. But here in geology, inorganic means that it is not alive. It's never been alive. And then finally, the last characteristic is that it has to have a definite chemical composition, meaning the elements that make up each mineral doesn't vary very much from mineral to mineral. So now we're going to get into each of those five characteristics in a little bit more detail. And remember, the first characteristic for what defines a mineral is that it has to be naturally occurring. This means that it has to form through some kind of natural geologic process, whether it's lava coming out of a volcano, whether it's salt forming in our oceans, it has to happen naturally. So anything that's synthetic, that's man-made, that is not naturally formed, can never be a mineral. So I like to think about the difference between diamonds and a fake substance called cubic zirconia. If you've ever gone to Claire's and gotten fake diamonds that look gigantic, but you only spent $10 on them, those are cubic zirconia. And those cubic zirconias are not mineral. Because they're man-made in a lab, they are not naturally occurring. So that's one of the biggest differences between a $100,000 diamond and that $10 cubic zirconia from Claire's. But the second defining characteristic of a mineral is that it has to have an orderly crystalline structure. And I know this part sounds really weird at first. But it's just the way that the atoms are arranged in a repeating pattern inside of the mineral. So here, if we look at this diagram, we'll see that the different atoms, we have those purple ones and the green ones, they're locking together or bonding into this cubic pattern. But the way that they arrange themselves repeats in this cubic pattern throughout the entire mineral, which is going to affect the overall crystal shape. If we look at the larger part, at part D in the image, where it's actually showing us the crystals of this mineral, they look like little cubes because the atoms themselves are arranged in cubes inside of it. And this is what we call an orderly crystalline structure. The atoms just repeat a specific shape in the way that they bond to each other throughout the entire mineral. And sometimes we can see this atomic arrangement just by looking at the mineral itself. But we still have three more characteristics to go through. The third is that a mineral always has to be a solid. It can never be a liquid or a gas because of our last defining characteristic. In order to have an orderly crystalline structure, the atoms have to be locked in one place. If they were moving around like they can in a liquid or in a gas, they wouldn't have that orderly crystalline structure. Only solid materials can have that, which is why it's our third defining characteristic. Our fourth characteristic is that minerals are generally inorganic. And remember, there's a difference in what organic and inorganic means in a geology class like this versus a chemistry class. In chemistry, we talk about organic as having carbon and hydrogen inside of it. What kind of elements are in it? But here in geology and in earth sciences, we think about organic as, is it alive? Has it ever been alive? So we can see that minerals are almost always inorganic. They're forming naturally in processes that happen over really long periods of geologic time. They're not forming from things that are alive or that were alive. But there's a little weird caveat to this because some organisms actually create minerals inside of their bodies. So living organic beings like humans make minerals inside of our bodies. And if you think about like our teeth and our fingernails and our bones, these are all minerals. But the minerals that we're creating in our body, those themselves are not alive. If I have to get a tooth removed, that tooth can't stay alive outside of my body. It's requiring resources for my diet. So, because of this, even though a human, an organic being, is creating a mineral, that mineral or the tooth itself is inorganic. It is not alive. But we're going to see in our next chapter on rocks that rocks are made up of minerals. And this is some things that students get confused about. Think of it as different Legos. If I have a bunch of different sizes and different colored Legos, each individual Lego block would be a mineral. But once I start combining those different sizes and different colored minerals or Lego pieces together, I'll be combining them into what's called an aggregate of different minerals, which we just call rocks. So when we start building rocks out of those different minerals, We're going to see that the rocks actually get a lot of the individual properties from those minerals. So, you've probably seen a rock called granite. We see them a lot in houses when it's our countertops in our kitchens and our bathrooms. We see them a lot at restaurants and our dining tables or in the bathrooms there. And the reason we choose granite is because it's really hard. And the reason why it's really hard is because of the minerals inside of them. Minerals like quartz and hornblende, the properties of these minerals make them very hard. So when we start combining them together, we're going to end up with a rock that has really hard properties. But we're also going to see that some rocks are made up of non-mineral matter. So most of the rocks that we encounter are just going to be a bunch of different minerals that are kind of cemented together. But there are going to be the rare occasions where we can see rocks that have non-minerals inside of them. And this is going to be where something either doesn't have a crystalline lattice, in the case of obsidian, which we'll get to in our next chapter, or if it's something that has living material inside of it, such as coal, which we burn for a lot of our electricity needs here in the United States.